Hello and welcome to another episode of the Trash Talk Podcast. I'm generally deaf, Smokey Rameriz. How are you doing?
I'm good, and I am back with another episode of the Trash Talk Podcast.
That you are! And because it's such a fitting topic, today's topic is crossovers!
Yes!
From full on two-parters
right now, as a matter
to
of fact.
Guest appearances like this one, crossovers are all over the media, and today we're going to talk about them.
Yeah, absolutely.
Where do you want to start?
That's what I was about to ask you.
Okay.
Well, what's your favorite type of crossover?
I would think that just out of principle, it's the classic TV show two-parter, right? Where you have one part of one show and another part on the other. That does sometimes come with a complication if you're trying to watch one of those shows. All of a sudden, you have a random episode in the middle that doesn't 100% fit, which is not so great. But I do still think that that is probably, as a general matter, the best kind of crossover. At least in terms of like TV show-wise.
Yeah. Well, it does tune in some extra eyes to the other show, obviously, but like you said, it doesn't usually run congruently with the other storylines that are going on because it stands as like a one-off episode. Like, you really can't work in a whole new set of characters into the plot of what's already going on in your story, right? So
and
it makes sense, but it does help get new eyes on both shows, which is the main reason for doing it.
Yeah, and I guess that kind of brings up one of the big questions that I have when I come up with this topic, which is, how do you make a good crossover, right? Because if you basically just make an entire episode dedicated to just, oh, character X meets character Y, but you don't actually weave in any of the ongoing plots, it's kind of stupid. But at the same time, if you do weave the ongoing plots in too heavily, and people are normally only watching one of the shows, then it might be difficult to follow all of the plot elements that are suddenly introduced from the other show. So,
yeah.
It's
which makes me wonder how they pulled off the Ninja Turtles and the Power Rangers crossover episode. I want to go back and see that. And you guys probably are not aware, but we talked a little bit about this and the list of such episodes where they had crossovers and stuff. But I want to say it was the first one on the list. I'm actually pulling it up right now.
It was
okay. So it wasn't the first one on
the list.
Yeah, the second one on the list after the Arrowverse. I don't know much about the Arrowverse. So
the Arrowverse
looks like the flat
is by the CW. It was obviously started by the TV show Arrow, hence the name. And then you got other shows that came into the verse, like The Flash, Supergirl, DC Legends of Tomorrow. It's a shared universe. And it's kind of a shared universe by design. So having crossovers within that universe isn't really that shocking, right? Because it's kind of built around the idea that they're all in the same universe. Well, technically, Supergirl is a parallel universe at first, but that's it's a whole other discussion. And so they actually used to crossover annually. So they would, like, every year there would be, like, a big crossover with, like, all of the shows involved.
Oh, wow.
And for the most part, those were actually pretty good, but also they did also not tie that heavily into the ongoing shows of the ongoing stories of the individual shows. So it's kind of like everyone paused.
Yeah.
We're doing a thing and then keep going afterwards.
But. Yeah. So those were all DC characters, obviously. I imagine you could do the same thing with Marvel. But what people are really waiting for is the crossover from DC to Marvel. That's been a big point of contention for many, many years. People want to see these crossovers between companies like that who will never work with each other, obviously.
Well, you say never will work with each other, but it is worth noting that they have, and there were actually quite a few Marvel DC crossovers in the comics. I believe the latest one being in the 90s.
Really?
But yeah, there was the Avengers Justice League crossover, / Justice League Avengers. I believe they had both titles. Depending on, they were alternately publishing them. There was, I know there was Superman Spider-Man that was a crossover. There was a Batman Hulk crossover, which I guess the idea being their names are both Bruce. I don't know. There was JLA Avengers, and there was also, I believe there's also JLA versus Avengers, which I believe, because there were definitely two JLA Avengers crossovers. One which was like a four-parter, yeah. And the other one was, I don't actually recall. Obviously, that also led, at one point, one of those led to the Amalgam Universe being created, which was, as part of one of those crossovers, they actually merged the worlds, but not just as in the characters from both exist in one world, but they literally merged the characters, right? So they merged Batman and Wolverine into a new character called Dark Claw, and Superboy and the other Spider-Man, Ben Reilly, were like Spider-Boy, and Doctor Strange and Professor X, I think, were merged, and there was a bunch of those, and they had like a bunch of one-shot issues of the stories of those merged characters, which kind of were just treating it as if they were just an issue of their ongoing comic book series, as if they actually existed, but they also, all of them only got one issue, really. I think they only got one, or they only got a very short run at the very least.
See, I don't know that much. I mean, I've watched a bit of the movies, but I've never actually went through the comics. I had no idea, because people ask for it all the time. I didn't know they actually made comic books of the crossovers there. That's crazy. We need some movies for that.
It's got to be a lot harder, right? Because those comic book companies were not making nearly as much money as the movie companies are now. And while yeah. there is a chance that we'll see another comic crossover, because like Disney and what, Discovery at this point owns DC, I believe. Well, owns Warner, who owns DC. They are like huge companies, and their comics businesses are very small in comparison. But actually getting Marvel Studios and what is it, Warner Brothers Films or whoever makes the DCU work together would be unlikely, I feel like.
Yeah, because you, like you said, you have those big companies, and it takes a lot to get them to agree on who gets how much of the cut.
It's that, and it's also just the whole thing of like, oh, are we propping up their IP more than they are ours, right? It's not just the money, it's also like...
Yeah, yeah.
They almost don't want to... Because capitalism these days works in a way where it's almost about like just trying to ruin the competition rather than just being the best, right? And the whole like the rising tide lifts all ships thing is not exactly how they approach making their media. So intercompany crossovers are difficult.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why we see mostly the crossovers we do see are coming from the same company. Because I was just thinking about that while looking at my shirt in the camera there. The Freddy versus Jason movie, which was amazing. I mean, I know a lot of people hate on Freddy versus Jason. They're like, oh, that's the worst one of all the Jason movies and the Freddy movies, because it came along at a time where people love to be music critic or movie critics, and they were just going to hate anything they saw anyway. And people hate sequels in general, for the most part, right? Anyway, like, it's the cool thing to go, yes, I can't wait for this movie, but then as soon as it comes out, you have to get on the internet and bash that movie. That's just the cool thing to do. Everybody seems to do it. But anyway, I love Freddy versus Jason. And they left it open at the end of the story to where we could move on to bringing in other characters, like maybe Pinhead or, you know, whoever it may be, Leatherface, you know, something like that. We never got to see it. I guess they couldn't work it out with the other characters. But we did see Freddy versus Jason because they are both owned by the same company. Wes Craven, as a matter of fact, made both of those. I would like to see more, though, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, intercompany crossovers are rough. And while the same IP, if someone owns the same IP, that's a lot easier. What's also sometimes interesting is licenses, right? So going back to comic books for a second, there are a lot of comic book crossovers because companies will just license their IP to like IDW or Marvel or whatever. And that company then has fairly free reign to make comics with those IPs. And they'll sometimes cross over multiple IPs that they have the rights to. So IDW has like the rights to, I think, Star Trek and Transformers and like a bunch of things. And so that they, I think they used to actually do like, I think annual crossover events where they had like almost all of the lines crossing over, despite the fact that most of those were just licensed IPs from other people. And so there's interesting stuff happening there as well. Marvel, of course, used to make Transformers comics and Doctor Who comics, which would also sometimes cross over with Marvel characters. As a matter of fact, Marvel these days has the licenses to Alien and Predator, although I don't know if they've done a crossover, but they have done at least an Alien comic. I don't actually know if they've done any Predator comics since then.
There was an Alien versus Predator movie in the 90s, right?
Yes, there was a...
Yeah, I think so.
I mean,
yeah.
Alien and Predator, I believe, are also owned by, I guess, 20th Century Fox, which I mean, Disney owns now anyway, so... so those cross over with one another, but I was talking about, I don't think they've crossed over Alien with Marvel, for example.
Gotcha.
I mean, what they did do, though, is when they got the rights back to Conan the Barbarian, they did put him in the Marvel Universe again. So
really?
Yeah, Conan the Barbarian is in the Marvel Universe in the comics, and that isn't even the first time.
Oh, wow. What about Xena?
I don't know if there were ever any Xena comics. I mean, there probably were, but I'm not aware of any run of anime.
I don't actually. I was thinking because wasn't she even in the episodic show? She was crossed with. Oh, it may have been Hercules. Maybe not.
Hercules.
Yeah, it wasn't Conan. It was Hercules, wasn't it?
Xena was a Hercules spinoff originally. So she first appeared on Hercules and then got her own show.
Yeah, so it wasn't Conan. Was there ever a Hercules versus Conan? I want to say, like, way back in the day that might have happened.
I mean, I haven't heard of it, but it's not like you can trademark Hercules, so...
because that's...
I mean, obviously, if you want to get the actor from the show and want to reference things that happened in the show, but...
yeah.
If you just want Hercules versus Conan as your headline, you just need to own the rights of Conan.
yeah, definitely. You know what everybody wanted that never happened in video games? Everyone wanted Street Fighter versus Mortal Kombat. Never happened. We did see there was a Capcom game. Was it Street Fighter versus X-Men? Something like that?
There was definitely Marvel vs. Capcom as well, where you also had other Capcom characters like Mega Man there.
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
I mean,
we never got the Mortal Kombat versus Street Fighter. That's what everybody wanted.
It's interesting because fighting games seem to be kind of prone to crossover in general, right? You have Marvel v. Capcom, Super Smash Brothers, which is Nintendo's series. You had Sony and Sega All-Stars, which was kind of their response to the Super Smash Brothers series. But you have these like crossover fighting games, so like the whole premise is that. And then sometimes you also have just random guest characters in fighting games, right? I think there was one of the Tekken games had a Street Fighter character in it, or the other way around, or something like that. And Injustice had Scorpio in it from Mortal Kombat.
Oh, wow.
I think they were made by the same studio, so again, it's not that surprising, but and also other fighting games sometimes just had random characters, sometimes even from non-fighting franchises, just as like unlockable characters or something, so there actually is a lot of overlap in general in that space, but not necessarily between those two in particular, I think.
Man, I still wanted to see it. I would like to see a movie of that to this day. Probably never going to happen because the two entities are still owned by separate companies, I'm sure. But back to this Power Rangers versus Ninja Turtles. I need to see this show. And if anyone has seen it, like, let us know in the comments because I want to see that. I'm probably just going to go ahead and watch it. Probably before this comes out, I will have seen this.
Yeah, I mean, it's
because this is like...
It's like Power Rangers in Space. This is
my childhood right here.
It's Power Rangers in Space episode 3 or 4 or something. I looked it up earlier. I think this is just one of those one-way crossovers. I don't know if it goes both ways.
Probably not. I mean, I didn't even realize there was a Ninja Turtles live-action episodic show running. I mean, I watched the cartoons as a kid.
Yeah, me too.
But I didn't realize there was live-action.
I
But of course, I
knew there were live-action movies.
The first.
But I didn't know about the shows. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, there are much more recent live-action movies as well, but there were also older ones before that. But the more recent ones are trying to look more realistic, and Seamus is in it, and, you know, like...
Seamus, yeah. He was a Bebop or Rocksteady, one of those two. yeah. That was great, though. That was a really good movie. I think it was only the first one I saw.
I honestly haven't seen it.
Maybe I did see one.
Was there a second one?
Yeah, definitely. I might have actually seen both of them. It was crazy, though, because they're using CGI turtles, and they're, like, giant and hulked up compared to the movies from the 90s where they were smaller guys, you know, because they were supposed to be ninjas, and they were supposed to move through tiny spaces undetected. But nowadays, in the newer movies, they are gigantic and, like, giant wrestlers looking, which is why Seamus probably plays in it. But, what's another good one? Phineas and Ferb and the Adventures. I never thought that would be a crossover.
I had actually known about that one, but I also haven't seen it. It seems like an odd choice. And also the Avengers, by the one picture that we have here, do seem to have a different art style, which is interesting crossovers. In cartoon crossovers, it happens
completely
sometimes
completely out of place.
Where you'll have the characters from one show just keeping their original art style appearing in the other, and it's a bit jarring.
Yeah.
It seems like the Avengers are significantly taller than any of the other characters, although most of those are kids, of course, but I think Candace should be roughly adult-sized.
Yeah. Oh, that would be cool to see, like, the Avengers and Teen Titans together or something like that. Yeah, but I guess you said there was an Avengers and Justice League crossover, huh?
Yeah, there was that, and I think there was a Teen Titans X-Men crossover. I don't know if there was ever...
Oh, wow.
...ever an Avengers Titans crossover.
So apparently, we talked about this earlier, too, but Supernatural... fell into the Scooby-Doo universe at some point. That's pretty hilarious. I can't wait, because I am watching the Supernatural episodes now. I just finished season one. Apparently, there is a ton of seasons.
I think there are 15.
I can't wait till I get to that. Oh. The stress of not knowing who to trust. Sorry, I was looking through the website and it started playing an ad.
Ah, don't you love auto-playing ads with sound on?
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, apparently they get to a point where they fall into the Scooby-Doo universe, huh?
That is in season 13, the episode Scooby Natural.
It'll be a while.
That one was actually very good. That might have actually been the best episode of the season, I don't know. But I don't remember exactly what happened in what season, but that one was actually very entertaining. Because they do very much play around with the concept of them being in the Scooby-Doo universe. And it is actually genuinely funny.
I can't wait till I get to this. Oh, I do remember this from when I was a kid, though. The Jetsons meet the Flintstones. I absolutely remember this. I want to say they even, at one point, it must have been in the early to mid-90s when this came out. And they actually aired it as like a primetime movie, as a matter of fact, not only just like Saturday morning cartoons, but I want to say they aired this as like a primetime movie that families gathered around the TVs to watch at that time. Obviously they were both Hanna-Barbera.
I was gonna say, easy to
pull that off.
Kind of back to our previous point, right? They're both Hanna-Barbera properties. They have pretty much the same animation style, so it's not even like you have to figure out, are we gonna redraw the characters in the other style or something. I remember there's a theory, of course this episode kind of makes it not work, that the Jetsons, because their city, city's in the sky, is literally just living above the Flintstones, and like, it's actually in the same time, and like, so society like diverged into people going back to like caveman times, and people using modern technology to live in the clouds, but obviously... Since this is a time travel episode, it doesn't quite work, but it is a fun
episode. Yeah, this episode kind of kills that, but that is a pretty interesting theory, because it would make sense in a way, you know? Although, when you watch the Flintstones, you would think you would see the poles, because all of their community dwellings are on poles that reach all the way down to the front.
I mean, I'm sure it wasn't perfectly thought through, but the idea is still interesting. But yeah.
Yeah, it's, yeah.
It's both a fairly logical crossover, as far as, again, two Hanna-Barbera properties that look very similar. But at the same time, it does seem kind of odd, just if you consider just the time points that they're supposed to take place in and the differences in technology level. Although, of course, the Flintstones are not as primitive as you might think, given that they use dinosaurs as tools, effectively.
Yeah,
they have like definitely. The Bronchiosaurus as a crane, and stuff like that. Yeah,
yeah. Oh, the biggest one of recent times. I think this has to be. I mean, they have others below this, like Chicago Med and Chicago Fire and Chicago PD.
Yeah, again,
Station 19 and Grey's Anatomy.
The Chicago ones, right? Those are obviously set in the same universe, right? This is not.
Yeah.
Not exactly. One of those where, like, those shows existed and they eventually crossed over because someone thought it would be funny, but, like, those shows are, like, I think most of those got backdoor pilots in pre-existing shows, and so those are always meant to be a shared universe. I believe they also have shared characters anyways outside of crossovers, so they've had multiple crossovers.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of like the Arrowverse thing, where it's, like, this is just kind of meant to cross over, right? It's almost not that exciting to talk about.
Yeah, but which is why I made this one particularly was so big when it happened. But it was the Simpsons and the Family Guy crossover, which I want to say this was like 5-6 years ago. It wasn't that long ago when it happened. And it was crazy because you got Matt Groening and Seth MacFarlane, both with completely different animation styles. Characters look nothing alike. You got all these yellow people and then all these weirdly shaped normal colored people, I would say. But it was really weird that they actually had a crossover of those two entities. Did you see it?
I think I have seen clips from it, but I haven't seen the entire episode.
Oh, yeah. It's great. You should go back and watch it at some point in time. But that's one of those where they had to get two different companies together to pull this off in the end. Then both of them had, well, actually, I want to say, I know Family Guy had parodied The Simpsons at different points in time because they parody many, many shows at different points in time. I don't know that The Simpsons had ever parodied The Family Guy. Maybe they had at some point, but not that I had seen.
I want to say
that it was pretty interesting.
I want to say they might have done a couch gag, but they have also done those for all sorts of things. You know, when the show opens and they're like hosting on the couch. They might have done one of those.
Yeah, yeah.
For Family Guy, but
yeah, absolutely.
I don't recall. But yeah, to me, those shows are almost somewhat fungible, right? Like, The Simpsons, Family Guy, American Dad, those are all kind of the same thing. I mean, I get that they're separate things, and obviously The Simpsons visually also stands out, but it's all kind of the same thing anyways to me.
It is. I mean, the same storyline. Although Family Guy, American Dad, and The Cleveland Show are all Seth MacFarlane, so they are all pretty much the same, and they have characters that cross over.
I mean, yeah, The Cleveland Show is literally a spinoff.
Yeah, exactly. That's a direct spinoff. But American Dad, they've had episodes where the characters have ran into each other from The Family Guy and from American Dad. Like, they'll be at the bar and run into each other or something, you know, and there's Roger the Alien. Out of nowhere. But anyway, can you think of any better ones, or should we move on?
One thing that I do find a little bit interesting to note, right, we talked about Chicago. They also cross over with Law & Order Special Victims Unit at one point.
Oh, that makes sense.
Obviously, all of the Law & Order shows cross over with one another. I mean, they're all made by Dick Wolf, so yeah. I believe Chicago also crossed over with FBI at one point, because those shows, FBI, FBI Most Wanted, FBI International, those are also made by Dick Wolf. And Law & Order has also in the past crossed over with New York Undercover, also made by Dick Wolf. Well, they haven't directly crossed over, but they have sub-shared characters. And has had crossovers with Homicide: Life on the Street, which is interesting because that was not a Dick Wolf show, and I think they were actually on a different network too. So,
oh wow.
And they had like three full-on two-part crossovers, one of which actually inspired this episode in a way, because what I was going to say, they've done very well in the first crossover, actually, was that I think both of the parts in the crossover could be watched individually as part of that show without really feeling too off. which I think is very impressive.
Oh.
So they basically had a case in New York in Law and Order that they basically solved, and then in Homicide, they were looking for an accomplice of that guy. They were like, oh, he didn't work alone. Like, turns out that guy that did something crazy in New York wasn't working alone. And then they just had an episode where they were looking yeah. for the accomplice. And so while the characters
that's awesome.
Well, the characters did also cross over, like, oh, we have some cops from Baltimore here, we have some cops from New York coming over. But the shows, because it's just like, oh, some characters are coming over to help us with a case that happens to cross jurisdictional boundaries, but both are sort of separate cases, but also connected. I think you could watch yeah. either one of those separately, which is a very interesting yeah. idea. Which most crossovers that do take place over multiple shows don't do. And it's fine that they don't do that, but obviously if you have to watch the other part, that's really terrible in syndication, right? When they're like, oh, we're showing like 5 episodes of Law and Order, and how is this episode going to end? You're never going to find out because we don't show Homicide on this channel. It's like, okay, great.
yeah. Yeah, exactly. I do like the idea, though, that multiple shows can exist in the same universe. You don't have to just accept that each individual show is in a separate universe. So I think, in the end, crossovers are very interesting.
Yeah.
Don't know how to close it out of that.
I mean, the shared universes are also not that rare, but sometimes it's interesting when I think things that weren't meant to be shared universes to begin with then end up becoming them. So that I think I find particularly interesting.
But, yeah. Like the Family Guy and The Simpsons. Yeah.
But those obviously
that's why it was so big.
The most dangerous in some ways because you have to be careful. I mean, comedy shows are inherently a bit more flexible with canon. But if you have like dramatic shows
mm-hmm.
and you cross over something completely different, it's always a bit dangerous because like, oh, right, like if Law and Order cross over with The X-Files, which they sort of have, then it's like
yeah.
one of those shows has aliens. The other one does not. when I say they sort of cross over, yeah. I mean that John Munch, originally from Homicide, later on Law and Order SVU, also appeared on X-Files in like one episode. It's not a big-ass uh-huh. crossover, but... If you're watching Law and Order, you might as well consider it not canon, so.
I did find it funny that, what was it, Cops that crossed with the X-Files?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although, my understanding is that it's just an X-Files episode in the style of Cops.
Yeah, that is.
The other way around doesn't really work. Sense. Because Cops is apparently a reality TV show, so you can't really.
yeah.
You can't really have aliens in that one.
What is non-fiction? Oh, that would be awesome, though, if there was an episode of Cops where the aliens showed up. yeah, that's it.
I mean, it could have been like
this episode of
like an April Fool's episode or something.
yeah. yeah, it says this episode of X-Cops brings together representatives of two very disparate genres. Sorry, I'm trying to see if it actually tells exactly how they pulled it off. But it doesn't necessarily say.
Yeah, I think I just went to the Wikipedia page of Cops and then Control-F for X-Files, and then I found a mention about the episode in the style of Cops. But
Yeah. Yeah, it does say that it followed a formula with the anarchy of the unscripted Cops. It's like a precursor to Wellington Paranormal. Never seen Wellington Paranormal, but
well,
apparently they filmed that in that style.
It's a show from New Zealand. It's a comedy of paranormal investigators. I think I've seen trailer once. I thought it looked vaguely... I read the script, I thought it was kind of interesting. I saw the trailer, I wasn't that excited by it, and I never ended up watching it, but... Yeah.
Mm. I like to make fun of paranormal investigators, so I would like to see that.
Well, I mean, that one, I believe, was scripted, so it's not like a haunted house thing, but like, yeah. I think it was scripted, but in the style of a sort of more, like, I mean, I guess the other ones are also sometimes scripted, but they weren't yeah. making it this
They are. oh, yeah. I mean, it's completely off topic, but, I get so what's the good word? Almost outraged at watching those paranormal shows because they all do the same thing. They'll walk into with this equipment that there is no exact science behind. They're just like, this is my ghost hunting equipment, you know? Like, how do you even know that that thing works? For one, there's no way to prove that it works. But anyway, they set it down and they're like, okay, spirit, blow out these candles and let us know you're here. Like, if I was a spirit, I don't want to do that. I'm going to kick you in the ass or something, you know? I'm not going to just jump and do whatever you say. Like, make this needle on this machine move. Like, no, I'm not going to do that for you. Like, well, you see, why would a spirit just start jumping through hoops just because some random person walked into their house and says, do this?
You the needles on the machine, you see, are actually detecting electromagnetic radiation or whatever. And
yeah,
if that... And ghosts just passively give that off so you can detect them. Now, there is some EMF just generally around, and if you're near, say, electrical wires, it goes up, right? So it's not that shocking, but I actually saw, I don't know where it was. I mean, it was on YouTube, but I don't remember who made it, but there was a really great debunk of those haunted house kind of shows that was also framed as one. So they were basically demonstrating, like, oh, here's this spooky thing that happened to us. And it's like, and here is the scientific explanation why that actually happened. So
that's how we did it. Yeah.
And like, things was like, oh, you hear like whispers on the audio and they're like, they put the subtitles on the screen and you can actually almost hear that they're saying that. But then if they just played without the subtitles and it's like a different segment, they're like, you can't hear it. But as soon as they put on the subtitles, you can hear it, right? Because it's a whole like Yanni Laurel thing where it's like,
exactly.
If you're primed to hear a certain thing, you're more likely to hear it. And so if they put on the subtitles,
And I'm sure no matter what words they put up on there, you're going to hear those words.
To a degree, I mean, it depends a little bit on what it sounds like. But yeah, there's definitely a lot of latitude.
Yeah, there. Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, you can write out the Declaration of Independence in the lower third Chiron and get someone to hear that. But if it's within reason, yes. But other than, I mean, like I said, it's completely off topic. But the machine that scans through the radio stations, like it'll scan through all the AM radio stations and just pick up words here and there from different radio stations, and that's supposed to be the entity communicating with us somehow. I
think that was the premise of the movie Bumblebee.
Was it? You're talking about the Transformers?
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's how he communicated. Yeah,
he couldn't speak, so he's always the stations too. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, and that's supposed to be how the ghost can communicate with you, is by somehow this machine randomly scanning through radio stations and picking up words here and there from different ones.
I mean, hey, without any human input, it actually like created a sensible output. I might actually believe it, but obviously it doesn't. So.
Yeah.
Who cares?
Yeah. Yep. Exactly.
Let's move on to fact of the week. But anyway. What is your fact of the week?
Oh, fact of the week. Sorry. I would have had that already pulled up. I thought we were doing the halftime show.
That comes after facts. So that the halftime show is as close to the halfway point as possible, right? So we have a topic one, facts, halftime show, then topic two and songs. We used to actually, way back in the day, have the facts after the halftime show, but one viewer told us, hey, the halftime show is like actually very early on in the program, and it's like, why don't you do the facts before? And then we were like, that's a good idea, and then we did it.
Yeah. Okay. Did you know there is a 107-acre forest made up of a single tree?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you already knew about this. The trembling giant in Utah's Fish Lake National Forest includes over 47,000 quaking aspen trees. That's contrary to what the title says. 47,000 quaking aspen trees that share the same root system. Okay, I getcha. Some scientists estimate it's close to 1 million years old. Ah, so I guess that makes sense. If they're all on the exact same root system, it's technically that one tree.
Yeah, I mean, that's how, like, the largest living organism that was known for like a long while was, I think, a mushroom, because they also their mycelium. Yeah, exactly.
Mycelium. That's the word I was trying to think of.
The mycelial network connecting like all of the different heads, and they're all technically one being.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, it is an interesting fact. We've had it before, but it is an interesting fact nonetheless.
Oh, wow. Well.
Now, my fact of the week, I'm pretty sure we haven't had. Well, I mean, I should know that. I've been on every episode. And it is actually possible to have a baby born with the DNA of three people. Now, this is a procedure where they do intentionally manipulate the fertilized egg, or actually, I think an unfertilized egg as well, it doesn't matter really. So there are certain problems that can happen with mitochondria, where mitochondrial diseases can lead to the children dying within minutes of being born. And so there has been a method to replace the mitochondria in the egg cell with that of a different person. And so then you have your regular DNA from your regular S parents. All is normal, mm-hmm. but the mitochondria, which is normally inherited from your mother, is then from a third person. I suppose technically it could mm-hmm. be from the father, because mitochondria is not gendered. So I guess theoretically you could take it from the father, but in this concept it's usually taken from a third party. To not make these mitochondrial diseases happen. Now, there have only been fewer than five babies born with this method, according to the Human Fertilization and Embryology Authority, the first one having been born in 2016 in the United States to a Jordanian family. And I mean, fewer than five means at most four, I guess. But yeah, no, this is a method that exists, and apparently it's safe. And you can effectively have three people's DNA making up your own. I mean, at the end of the day, you, as the resulting human being, are still the same as every other human being, in that you have DNA, you have mitochondrial DNA. It's just that the mitochondrial DNA happens to not come from your mother. But in and of itself,
but your mitochondria can be repaired that way. The question is, who pays the child support? That's what everybody wants to know, right?
So, generally speaking, DNA testing would not be done on mitochondria, so it would just be the regular parents.
Oh man, I'm sure there's a lot of people that are disappointed right now.
Which brings us to the halftime show. We wanted to do Hurdle again. We've talked about Hurdle decades before. It's very fun, and I like the decades of it all, but there are a bunch of new categories as well. So I'm going to open this page, and any preferences? Do we want to go do decades again? Do we want to do some of the genres? Do we want to do rock? Do we want to do like number one hits? Country? Oh god.
Let's do the decades.
Let's do the decades. Are we going to work our ways up from the 60s again, I guess? Do we do 50s? Okay. We start with 60s. I only know like one or two 50 songs. It's not going to be that productive.
I might know a few if they were really big hits.
Okay, maybe if we end up feeling like we need more.
Yeah, if we have time. Yeah. Ooh. It's acoustic guitar work. Sounded like it could be Led Zeppelin for a second. Just because, not that that's Stairway to Heaven, but it is acoustic guitar work similar to Stairway to Heaven.
Well, we have Living Loving Maid, Whole Lot of Love, and Dazed and Confused as the only Led Zeppelin songs in here.
It's not a Whole Lot of Love and Dazed and Confused. I'm not sure about Living Loving Maid. I don't know that song right off hand.
Instead of skipping, we might as well try it. But, I mean, obviously our success chances are fairly low, since we just guessed it sounds kind of like that band.
Exactly.
Guess what? It wasn't that one.
Yeah.
It's more of the same.
Yeah, more of the same.
The problem is, acoustic guitars were very common in the 60s, right? So it could be
exactly,
anyone.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, unless it breaks into a familiar riff pretty soon, it's going to be really hard.
I mean, we can skip if you want to. Skip.
Yeah, let's skip one. Ah, it still's not giving us anything.
It almost doesn't feel longer, because it's just more of the same.
Exactly, yeah. I think we're going to need another skip at least.
I mean, at least with every skip, like, the skipped two becomes longer.
Yeah. Wow. They're not giving us any on this one. Because that's just the intro, so obviously at some point it's going to break into a familiar riff. If we do know the song.
Unless it's, like, not a rock song, and it actually... Because, like, this is just what music was like in the 50s, you know? Like...
Yeah.
Before the Beatles, this was what music was like.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it could be a Frank Sinatra song, for all we know.
Yeah. You want me to try Sinatra? I mean...
Might as well.
Oh, God, there are a lot of Sinatra songs in here.
Yes, there is.
I mean, okay, we actually don't just have Frank, we also have Nancy. But it's not My Way. I don't know the other ones.
No.
Jackson and Nice and Easy. Strangers in the Night. Oh, I'm vaguely familiar with that one.
Strangers in the Night.
I mean, it's obviously not Something Stupid. It's not These Boots Are Made for Walking, I'm pretty sure. It's not My Way, but the other ones.
No. Something Stupid. That's all Nancy. Well, oh no, there's
it's
Frank
both.
And Nancy.
Yeah. I don't think it's that one though. I think that one have more energy.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, unless you want to try one of the Frank Sinatras, you don't know.
Yeah, no, I think at this point we might as well skip. Blind guess okay. I don't think we've ever done a blind guess and just gotten it, right? Either we recognize the song or we don't.
Oh, no. Ah, no, it wasn't going to give us anything.
Feels vaguely familiar, but I don't have anything.
It does. It really does. But
it's also just giving me the vibes of, like, just, like you know, a movie scene where someone is sitting in a cafe or something, like, not... It doesn't
exactly.
necessarily have to be,
yeah.
like, I actually know the song. It might just be, like, something similar or actually this exact thing has been used in a movie, but, like, not necessarily the entire song, so I don't know. Do we just want to do the last skip and see what the entire segment sounds like?
Let's do that. Yeah. Still just the intro. Not a clue on this one.
I want to say, for some reason, it gives me slight Italian vibes, but that doesn't really help. That's a country. That doesn't help.
It feels like lounge music to me. That's why I said Frank Sinatra. It feels like, you know, like the guy's just performing in front of a lounge full of people.
I guess it's probably the same vibes I picked up on. It's probably because I associate it with Italian restaurants or pizzerias, I guess, specifically.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I guess we'll just give up on this one.
Yeah, we'll see who it is.
Barbara Streisand.
Oh, Barbara Streisand.
People.
I would have never got that one. Yeah.
Okay.
Not rock enough.
Yeah, let's do 70s. Hey.
All right. Okay. It's definitely 70s. You hear that organ come in.
It sounds familiar. I can't place it, but it sounds familiar.
It does. It does, like Iron Butterfly or...
I was thinking more in the direction of, like, When a Man Loves a Woman, that sort of a thing, but I...
Huh.
But I don't know.
Need a little more of it. Mmm. Does sound like it's gonna break into a love song.
Yeah. When a man loves a woman. Okay, it definitely isn't that, but it is.
Yeah.
I know I said it, but it's like, it feels like it's somewhere in that direction. Like sort of.
Yeah.
A little sort of soul bluesy, sort of in that direction.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Like that 70s R&B.
I guess it's probably just another skip for now, huh?
Yeah. Oh, come on, give me some more. And when it's going to do this, every single song is just going to be an intro that's unfamiliar.
It feels like that happens a lot with the Hurdles, where it's like, oh, you feel like you know this, but like it's like as soon as the actual beat starts or as soon as someone starts singing, you know it. But also, that only happens in like the last half second, if you're lucky.
Exactly.
Fucking hell. Let's skip again and see
what we get. Stop making these long intros.
Well, there was a trumpet there. It's starting to get going.
Yeah. It was about to break into something. I think if we get one more skip, we might get a little more info here.
It really wasn't that much more. It sounded like it was gonna get going and it just didn't.
It's one of these post the psychedelic blues bands. Like, it could be Pink Floyd, but then again, it could be
I could see that. Yeah.
It could even be like a slowed down R&B song.
Pigs, Time, Another Brick in the Wall, down. Wish You Were Here, Money. Well, it's not last three. I don't know about Time and Pigs. Those I'm not as familiar with, but.
Oh, I don't know. Time. Yeah, no. We just did Money recently, so it's not that one for sure.
Yeah, Money starts time. With Cash Register. It's kind of like Ka-Ching by What's Her Face.
Yeah, but... yeah.
Wish You Were Here. Oh, fuck, I have the wrong Wish You Were Here in my head, but it still isn't it. And Another Brick in the Wall, obviously. We don't need education.
Exactly.
I have Wish You Were Here by the Rednecks now in my head, which is not the same song at all, but it's better.
By the Rednecks?
Believe it or not, like yes.
The Swedish Rednecks?
Yes.
The same ones that did. Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Can I do?
Yeah, but Wish You Were Here is more like a ballad. It's like, wish you were here, neon lights, countrymen, wish you were here. But yeah, anyways.
I haven't heard that one.
And obviously the Wish You Were Here by Pink Floyd is like an entirely different song, but that I'm also familiar with, but... I'm not going to get the rhythm right now, but it's not this one. I think it's probably just time to listen to the entire snippet and see if we get anything out of it.
Yep. Nothing. It was just the same thing.
It feels familiar, but I feel like
I said, I'm going.
The fifth time you listen to it always sounds familiar, almost, right? Is it?
Yeah, exactly. I'm going with post psychedelic blues. But like I said, I can't pinpoint who it is.
I think this is one of those where we might kick ourselves when we see it, but I also don't know what to guess. So.
Yeah. Exactly. It's Rare Earth.
Get wow. ready. That doesn't sound too familiar.
I feel like I was more along the lines with Iron Butterfly then. Same genre.
Fair enough. I mean... I can't even guarantee that I've heard it before, but it still sounds vaguely familiar, but I think there are also a lot of songs that sound like that, especially from that time.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's move on to the 80s. All right.
The goal is to get one of these, right?
We'll just keep going until we get one.
Yeah. Oh, wait, I know that. But it's the 80s. Actually, yeah. My first thought was something from the 60s, as a matter of fact, but that sounds very familiar. So
it feels kind of Beach Boys, but that's like, yeah, those are older, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But it sounds familiar enough that we can probably get this one, right?
Yeah, but probably not on just this, huh?
No, not at all.
Weird enough, this is something else on the sevens. I feel less certain now. Like, I mean, not that I was certain of anything, but I feel less confident than I know it now.
Exactly. The first little few licks is like, oh yeah, I know this. What is it? And then you hear the second part. You're like, maybe I don't know this.
I just recalled right, another song that sounds kind of somewhat similar, but it's not it. Which would be I'm a Believer.
Yeah.
But, and I saw her face, now
I'm a believer. But, yeah.
That's not what that is. But it's kind of like that.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I don't think that's it, but yeah.
I mean, if it's in here and if it's the right decade, I can try it, but, Believer, okay. That's something in there. I don't think it's the right decade, but even if it is, it's like, whatever. It's definitely not it.
Yeah.
Well, let's listen to more.
Yep. Nothing.
It feels like it's getting worse. Like, not as in the song is necessarily worse, but like, less recognizable.
Less familiar. Yes. Okay. I was confident after the first second, but not anymore.
I'm steadily losing confidence, which is the exact wrong direction for the confidence to trend.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess, like, skip right away, huh? Just...
Yes.
That feels a little more familiar, but...
Yeah, it does. It feels like it would be a Wham song, right? You wouldn't think so, because they have their own category for Wham.
Well, I mean, there are, what is that, 1, 2, 3, 4, there are like 8 Wham songs in here that it could be, so, you know. Whoops.
Yeah.
But Wham X-Lam.
Well, it's definitely not Freedom, which I thought was just George Michael's without Wham, but,
it's not Last Christmas.
No. It's not Wake Me Up Before You Go-Go, right?
No, it's not. Oh god, there's actually, now there's 10 now that I put the X-Lam, which means there might actually be more. It doesn't display more than that. They might just have the entire Wham catalog in here.
What is Wham rap? They had a rap song?
Evidently!
Oh wow.
Speaking of weird crossovers, Wham doing rap.
Yeah, exactly.
I let's just listen to more.
Alright.
Because we're not going to guess random Wham songs if there's like a dozen of them until we have it.
Exactly. Yeah. Oh, it does sound like one of their songs, though.
Any ideas in particular?
But then again, Then again, it does. I mean, a lot of the songs in the '80s, like the pop songs, sounded like that.
That's the problem, right? It's like, oh, this could definitely be an '80s song. It's like, yes, it's the '80s quiz.
Oh God. I mean, if you really want to try, I would just go for one of the Wham songs that we don't particularly know. Or we could skip.
I mean, I'm assuming we're not going to go for the Wham rap. What about Club Tropicana? No. This sounds very tropical.
Yeah, there you go.
Guess what? It wasn't it.
Imagine Shocker. That.
I couldn't understand what he was saying. I love typing words that they're singing in and just hoping it's the title.
I know.
I have won with that method before.
Something bicycle?
Bicycle, bicycle. I do ride my bicycle.
Definitely not Freddie Mercury. it sounds European, though, like one of the English singers. Like the Kinks or someone.
Well, it ain't one of the Sunset. Kinks,
their accent wasn't that big.
Well, Inks, okay, fair enough. Come Dancing is by the Kinks.
Well, let me bring a list of popular. I'm definitely saying it's English. Because he had that distinct English lyrical style.
Let's see. I mean, we're not going to... I mean, first of all, Googling seems a little outside of the boundaries. But second of all, we're not going to get it through that anyway. So we could either guess something or give up, I would say. I don't think... The less research you do, the more time we have for additional rounds to actually get something.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. All right. Wanted to get one right, but okay. Oh, I did get a quick list. Arithmetics, no. Talk, maybe. Flock of Seagulls, maybe. Tears for Fears, maybe. New Order, Pet Shop Boys, OMD, Thomas Dolby, Thomas Twins, and less popular people. It probably is one of those. Maybe it's Tears for Fears or one of them, but anyway.
Well, it's not Shout. It's not Mad World.
Definitely not Shout.
It's not Everybody Wants to Rule the World.
No.
I don't know. I don't know Sowing the Seeds of Love, Head Over Heels, Pale Shelter, Change. I don't know those.
Yep. No idea. Let's find out.
The Smiths.
The Smiths!
With This Charming Man.
Yeah, I was getting it close with the Kinks, but yeah.
Well, it's time for the 90s.
Yeah, and hopefully this one will work out better.
I was alive for a very small part of the 90s, so here we go. Which doesn't necessarily make it better, because I listened probably to more music from the other decades than is from the 90s, but let's go.
Oh, I know that one.
I was about to say, that's more your ballpark.
Yeah. That is Praz and ODB. Ghetto Superstar. That is what you are.
D and put Praz?
Yeah, just type in Ghetto Superstar.
Okay, Ghetto Superstar, Praz Michael... Submit. Yeah. I actually know this one. I just wouldn't have known how it starts. So.
Oh, yeah.
I mean.
If they would do more hip hop, I could nail these things, man.
I mean, I guess we could just keep going. 2000s, 2010s. That's certainly.
Hey, if we got time. Yeah.
I mean, at least the intro's getting shorter.
Show me how to make it. Oh God! I need more of it to get the hook. I know that song though. Show me how to lie. It's Offspring, right?
The Offspring with Want You Bad, You're Gonna Go Far Kid, Original Prankster, or Hit That are the four of the Offspring songs that we have.
Can you play the clip one more time?
I sure can.
You're Gonna Go Far Kid? You're gonna go far, kid, with a thousand lights and a big blue sky. Hit 'em right between the eyes. Yeah. I think that's it. Show me how to lie. You're getting better all the time and turning all against one. Isn't art that's hard to teach? A man of clever words sets off an unsuspecting hurt. And as you step back in the line, a mob jumps to their feet.
No one even knew it was really only you.
Nice work you did. You're gonna go far, kid. In a thousand
lives.
Yeah, good song.
That was impressive. I mean, I doubt I'm going to be the one to get the 2010s one, because the further we go into the the further up we go, the less likely I have to get it. But at least starting with the 90s, like, I'm probably more likely to get 80s and 70s, but yeah.
But yeah, more likely I am.
2010s. Oh, fuck.
Oh, I know that.
Is that LMFAO or whatever, the band?
Is it?
Sexy.
I can't tell you the artist, but I know that song. Yeah, I'm sexy and I know it. Yeah, that's it.
Yep. Okay. Never mind. I did get that one.
Yeah.
It's weird because it's not exactly the kind of thing that I would be proud of getting, right? It's like, like, I mostly know this one because it was A, overplayed, and B, kind of a meme, right? So.
Oh yeah, it was.
It's not that I like the song.
Just admit it. That's your kind of music.
You know what? It's not like anyone's pressuring us with time. Let's do 50s as well, really quickly. I don't have a lot of hope, but
that does sound familiar. Then again, we might play the next few seconds.
It sounds very generic, is my problem right now. Like, yes, it sounds familiar, but also, there's probably like a dozen songs that start like that.
It's definitely one of those teen hop songs of the 50s. Probably need a lot more than just a drum and a clap to get it, though.
Well, I don't know how long it's going to take until we get more, but let's see.
Not yet. Oh. Whoa, I'm trying to keep running through it until I get some lyrics. God, who was that? Oh my God. It was a black artist of the 50s. Jesus. And I can already tell you there's not going to be any words by the end of this. Because he just does that all the way for four or eight bars. And then he goes into the whoa,
In other words, either you're going to come up with it or not, but we're not going to get much more.
Yeah. I know the song. I can't think of the hook to actually come up with the word, with the title.
The thing is, this is definitely not going to get me there, and more of this exactly is also not going to get me there. So unless you can come up with something, yeah. Like this could be one of those where, like, if you sing some words, maybe I know the title, but by the time you have words, you probably know the title yourself. So
yeah, exactly. Yeah, play a little more of it. Maybe we'll get it. Is it? It's either Fats Domino or Little Richard. Nah, it's definitely not Little Richard.
Ain't There Shame, Blueberry Hill, I'm Walking, and Jambalaya.
Is it
by Fats Domino? It's not Jambalaya. I don't know the CCR version, but I'm pretty sure it's not Jambalaya.
No, it's not Jambalaya. And it's not I'm Walking, and it's not Blueberry Hill. It might be Ain't That a Shame.
I mean, let's just try it. We have one more guess anyways.
Yeah.
It was not that.
No, that's not it. All right. Who else could it be? Sam Cooke, maybe?
I'm actually not typing right. Cooke. No, we have Bill Haley and his comments and the Skylanders, which are coming up, and it ain't Rock Around the Clock. Not that it is.
No.
Not that we're ever thinking that, but that's the only thing that comes up. But Sam Cooke is COO. Yeah, he's just not in there.
K-E, yeah.
Yeah.
It's something we'll know the title once we see it, or at least I will. I know. It's not Benny King.
Ain't no sunshine when she's gone.
It's a good song, but it's not that one.
She's away. Yeah, you just said Benny King, and that was the first Benny King song that came to mind, so. Also, that's not from the 50s.
Oh, my.
Ain't No Sunshine is from the 60s, maybe 70s, but it's not from the 50s.
All right. Did we already play the entire thing?
Actually, I don't think we did. I think I just got the wrong guess and then never played.
Whoa. Yep. I can't come up with it, man. Who was it?
I guess let's skip the final one and see what it is. Thurston Harris with Little Bitty Pretty One.
Oh man, I would have never got the title, but I know the song. I would have never gotten that title.
We have been going for long enough, but I'm kind of tempted to ask if we want to do rock. Because that seems like probably up my ballpark.
Oh, let's try it.
But this is definitely the last one, because I don't want to do this all day, as much as it is enjoyable.
Yeah.
I mean, we definitely had a lot of fun, but let's see.
You got it?
Hang on, just before a moment, and the moment's gone.
It's gone. Oh my.
Rumbles to the ground.
Is that what it is?
Dust in the Wind, Kansas. Yeah.
Dust in the Wind. Oh, okay.
Kansas band.
We are dust in the wind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, that's the kind of stuff I'm looking for. Give me some Kansas.
Yeah. Yeah, you got it.
See, that is what I was looking for. I'm really happy that I did get that we did do that still. Like, because I was really hoping I was gonna actually like guess the song correctly that I enjoy, right? Like, the yeah. I was going to say Party Rock Anthem, the other one, the LMFAO one. It's actually, I know it. It's like, yeah, oh, sure, yeah. Right? It's a meme song, I know it, but... that ain't it. Oh, for the second topic, I actually... we didn't talk about it before, but I was thinking we do. Will you press the button? I didn't even pull it up. But okay. I have it. So, the premise is, as always, you get... one good thing with the downside, and do you do it or do you not? You can redesign yourself as you like and start your life over again with all your current knowledge. But there is a 1 plus n percent chance where n equals age, you will die every year in a gruesome manner.
Every year?
So there's a 1% chance in your first year, I guess. And then when you turn 1, there's a 2% chance, 3%, so on and so forth.
So basically, if you make it to 90, you would be beating the odds severely. Yeah. I mean,
even just making it to 50, right, where it's like, obviously it's a 50-50 shot, but all the times before that collectively will have become much more likely than 50%.
So there's a very rare chance that you're going to see middle age.
I mean, I would assume, I don't know exactly, but I would assume that the break-even point where it's equally likely that you have died until that point is somewhere in 25 to 30, somewhere in that range probably. So I don't think the odds are actually that good. I mean, then the question is, right, how long do you still expect to live? And
yeah. And how much, I mean, if you're terminal right now, you're gonna push the button, right?
I'm hoping to get a little more than 25 additional years out of this one. I haven't even gotten the first 25 done yet. So you know,
I mean, I'd be more inclined to push it than you, I would imagine, but I mean, I still think I've got at least 30, 40 years left, so.
That's the thing, right? And I mean, then the other question is, right, if you are only giving up a couple of years, starting over with all of your knowledge and being able to redesign yourself, but there is certainly, you could have a better quality of life in some ways, but you start your life over again. So I guess you go back to the past. So I guess the only knowledge you really need are the lottery numbers.
Then again, I mean, you could be a really famous shooting star. You have the knowledge to do that. But then, does it go back to
the year you
were born?
Predicting 9/11 is going to backfire.
Yeah, probably so.
The CIA is going to have some questions.
However, if you're an artist, you can go back and make hit songs before they come out.
Johnny B. Goode was actually first sung by Marty McFly.
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry, Calvin Klein,
think of the wealth you could accumulate, because if you just had a list of all the hit songs throughout the years, and you go back and remake them all before they come out, like 2 years before they come out, I mean, but then you're going to have a lot of people plagiarizing your stuff because they're going to think they wrote it when actuality...
Yeah, I mean, first of all, the first time you get that wrong and you accidentally make a song that has actually already been played at like a live concert but just not released yet, it's like,
true. Yeah.
I think the safer bet is probably like stocks or lottery numbers, right? Where...
True.
It's a very straightforward way of making money.
Sports almanac.
Back to the Future
sports
again.
Sports almanac thing. Yeah.
But yeah, I would say I will say not. No. I have enough life ahead of me, and you can change any one decision from your past, but you have to spend the rest of your life being unable to make more than a minimum wage.
Wait, can you read that one again?
You can change any one decision from your past, but for the rest of your life, you cannot make more than minimum wage.
I don't think I want that. Because the mistake I would change would lead to more money, but if I can't make that money, then what's the point?
Well, the rest of your life, so I guess henceforth, right? You cannot make more than minimum wage. So if I undo my decision in the past of not buying Apple stocks, right? I'm not that old. But then I have money, and it doesn't matter if I can't make much more, right? So,
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so what's the point of that?
No. The way I'm arguing it is like, the way I understand it is that from this point onwards, you cannot make more than minimum wage, but the past decision that you changed could give you enough money to where it doesn't matter how much money you can make henceforth.
Okay, so up to this point, I get you.
If changing any one decision by now includes not investing in Bitcoin, which is definitely a decision I made at some point. the Apple stock thing is like, I would have not, hadn't even considered buying them, right? But I had actually considered buying some Bitcoin before, right? Back when it was like less than a buck per coin, right? Like back when it was actually like cheap. Oh, wow. I don't know, maybe it was not quite that, but like it definitely was like orders of magnitude cheaper than now, right? So, and I was considering putting some money in, but I was like, nah, this is stupid. This is a gimmick, right? This is gonna not last.
If you put in $100 back then, you would be super rich now.
Right. So, and at that point, it's like, oh, now I'm super rich. And whoops, I can't get a high-paying job anymore. What a shame.
Yeah. Okay, I'd take that. I'd push the button.
25% did, but again, right, like the question, like this one is kind of tricky to interpret because of how it's written, so I honestly wouldn't put much stock in what people answer because
they're probably thinking that they're going to make it for their entire life, not from this point forward.
Right, and that's both probably valid interpretations from how it was written. Yeah. You will become the most charismatic and smooth-talking person ever. But you must embarrass and ruin your chances with whomever you are romantically interested in. Like, interested in right now, or like interested in for the rest of eternity?
Yeah, because then there would be no point.
Right, because...
But then again,
I mean, charisma,
if you're a smooth talker, you could end up taking over the entire world.
I mean, the question is, right, do I have to embarrass myself in front of all romantic interests, or just whichever current one I hypothetically have, which I don't currently have one, but, you know. Yeah. Because then it's like, oh, yeah, I lose my chance with that one person, but then I can just get the next one, right? It's like,
but you can get anyone you want if you're that good.
And...
Yeah, I'd take it.
I would take it, too. I mean, this is just an easy way to make a lot of money, right? Top comment says, doesn't matter. Anyone who have a crush on isn't actually real.
That person probably has some waifus out there.
They're called waifus, but... well, actually, you way. Know.
Yeah, I guess you know about those.
I spend too much time on the internet. I'm not going to deny that. This is a question for that person. You get to have madly passionate sex with your celebrity crush, but you died 10 years earlier than you would have.
Oh, man, but I want to know when it would be, I guess.
It's like, actually, you would have,
how do you know? Like,
you would have spent your last 10 years in a coma. Yeah.
But if I was going to, if I was going to live to be 100, I'm taking that.
I mean, I'm not taking that, right? Like, this is one of those, like, momentary pleasure versus long-term benefits, and, like...
Yeah, exactly. But then again, like, you would really like to know when you're going to die first to make that decision. But since you don't know, I would say not.
I mean, I would probably generally say not, and also, these questions are always a little bit weird for me, because... You're basically using magic to change someone's willingness to have sex with you, which feels very questionable.
Yeah, exactly. It is kind of wrong.
Okay, so 43% did, 57% did not. Top comment says, doesn't matter, had sex. What? Well, I mean, right? Like, why does it have to be that one specific person, right? I can kind of...
Yeah.
When was this question written? You have Steve Jobs' money, but you die when he does.
He's already dead.
Which was like 10 years ago or something, I don't know.
So you get the money? What, do we get to go back in time?
The dead can't die. Immortality. Top comment says, you can't actually die because he's already dead. So,
oh, he doesn't so maybe die if again. If you take it right now. Yeah, if you take it right now, you get to live forever.
Well, yes, but also right now he has no money. Because he's dead and he can't have possessions.
True, technically. Yeah, so, technicalities.
But, I mean, to be fair, that still gives you immortality, I suppose. And I love how this says, very long ago, and then the oldest comment that actually seems to be dated is 7 years ago. So, that tells you that he's been dead for at least 7 years.
Yeah, exactly.
I suppose I will not, because it's a stupid question, but yeah, let's do like one or two more good ones, and then... You have the ability to see behind you. It's called turning your head. But your vision becomes 5 times worse in both the front and the back. How do you quantify that?
That's just, I mean, because you already have the ability to look behind you.
I mean, I suppose he's saying like you have like 360-degree vision, or like you can see both front and behind you at the same time. It's not. I don't think he's literally saying you have the ability to turn your head. That...
But my vision is not that great in the first place, so
it's like you can now see in two directions at once, but you're also blind.
Exactly. If I make it 5 times worse, I'm not going to see anything.
Well, I'll have you know, my vision is actually great. No, I mean, I won't. This, like...
No.
Like, the surround vision is, like, marginally useful, but actually clarity of vision or distance or whatever is actually much more useful.
Yeah.
Top comment says, I can already see behind me. It's called turning around.
Yeah,
that's
exactly
what I'm saying. Okay, you have the ability to see the future at will, but you lose 2 of your 5 senses.
Oh. And we don't know which 2.
I mean, even if I could choose which 2, I probably wouldn't do it. I mean, the main questions are always like, seeing the future how, right? Like, do I actually like predict the future in a way that I can change it, or do I just know what's going to come?
Yeah, can I make money off of it? Because if you have enough money, you know, your senses, you can go without certain senses. You don't want to lose your vision or your hearing.
I definitely also
maybe
don't
smell.
Want to lose my...
Smell is definitely.
Yeah, smell is definitely what I can live without. I guess smell and taste, right? Taste is unfortunate, but because touch is also very important.
Yeah, you may need
like I feel like
touch more than taste.
I feel like, I mean, it depends, right? Like, if you still have pain, then at least touch isn't entirely lost, right? Where it's like, because no sense of pain is really dangerous because people hurt themselves.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
If you at least
die of infections and things.
If you at least have pain, that is, then losing your touch is not as bad, but I think it would still be much more impractical than you would realize. Because you use your touch so much, you don't even think about it sometimes.
Yeah.
You also wouldn't be able to feel wind, for example, right? If you don't have a sense of touch. I mean, you would be able to see, like, if, I don't know, something is, like, moving from the wind, but you wouldn't actually feel the breeze.
I think I could give up smell and taste for the ability to see the future.
I mean, but that's it, right? But it's like, if I can choose the senses, and I'll choose those 2, and the ability to see the future is actually useful, and as far as I can actually make changes with that, then yes.
Yeah.
But that's a lot of caveats.
Yeah.
Because if I just see the future...
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely like to know these things before I push the button, but...
Yeah, because if I can only see the future in as far as this is not written in stone, then that's actually terrible. Like, you know something's bad is going to happen, you can't change it, but that sucks. And then that one sucks, and then obviously losing 2 senses, it depends entirely on if you can choose them. I guess I'll tentatively say I will not, just because of all the caveats, but it's 40-60, and again, right, like this, the 40-60 doesn't mean anything because it depends entirely on how you interpret the question.
Exactly.
In a way, it's a win-win. You lose a sense of taste and smell and eat foods that are extremely healthy but normally would taste like crap.
Well, there you go. See?
Let's do one more because the one before this was weird. And this is a fun one. You gain perfect looks, whatever that means, but you lose an IQ point anytime someone compliments your looks.
No, I'm not taking that.
I mean,
because if you have perfect looks, you're going to be a complete moron within one day.
I mean, it might not be quite
you
as bad
survive
as
a week.
You know, as a man, I don't think it's quite as bad necessarily, but it's definitely going to ruin you fairly quickly.
Yeah.
Because men don't get compliments to the same rate as women do. Like, if you were a woman and you get perfect looks, like, that is done within minutes. Man. Like, as soon as you go outside, you're just done.
Yeah, you can't even speak after 8 hours.
But as a man, you could probably make it a couple months, but, like, that still isn't good.
Yeah.
I mean, also, I'm not that vain, but, yeah, no, this is definitely an I will not. If I'm vain about anything, it's about my IQ, right? Like, I mean, obviously, IQ is not a good measure of intelligence, blah, blah, blah. The test is flawed. If you prepare for it, you're better. Also, we don't know if there are other things that could be defined as intelligence that don't fall into the test. There is a lot wrong with the IQ testing, but even if you do take it at face value, it's like, no, right? I would consider myself an intelligent person, and I would like to stay that way. Top comment is saying how IQ tests are bad, but...
Yeah, that's what everybody says.
but again, right, like, even with IQ tests being flawed, there's still some correlation. It might not be perfect, but, like, if you score below 70 or score above 130, there is probably going to be some difference. It's not just how well you take tests.
And I've taken different ones that were... completely different, like
actual proper ones, or like online IQ tests.
Oh no, online ones.
Because those, as far as I know, those all suck. Basically,
they do. As a matter of fact, but I usually get around the same score. It's just that some of them deal off of like logic in general. Some of them are just logic, and then some of them are. How good are you at categorizing things and seeing patterns and whatnot?
I find a lot of the ones I see do like the figure turning, like the geometry, like the dice and like that sort of stuff. What do you normally score on those? You said it's fairly consistent.
Yeah. I guess my best score was 138 and my lowest score was around 128. And I've taken probably 5 or 6 of them, so they're usually around in the same area.
See, I got 139 on the... is it 39 or is it 29? I think it was 39. What is the... now I need to look at the distribution to remember. But it's 1 point below what Mensa wanted to qualify for membership.
Well, no. It depends on which test you take for Mensa, though, because one of them is 140, one of them is 130... And then there's one test that's like 120 something.
So 130 is the goal. So it was 129, not 139. I got that wrong. But so I got 129. Mm-hmm. But still, right? That's actually at least a somewhat proper test. But again, with the caveat that all IQ tests suck. That was the one that was provided by the Mensa Institute of Germany. Oh, the largest national groups are American Mensa with 50,000 members, British Mensa with 18,000 members in the UK and Ireland, and Mensa Germany with about 16,000 members. So yeah.
When in my younger days, I wanted to be in Mensa, and then I found out I wasn't quite smart enough to be in Mensa, so I gave up on that dream.
So again, right? I think. I'm probably going to retake the test this year because if you've taken the test, they give you a coupon for taking it for free the second time. Actually, Sergey didn't get one, so I guess he was too dumb. He got 119 because he was 10 points older than me. But I was like 1 point off of making it, so they had like when I got the results, they were like, "Hey, here's a code for it if you want to do it again." But it expires in September, so. I think it was this year. Might have been last year, so in which case I'm not going to do it again. But if it's this year, then I'm probably going to go there again and just try and see if I can make it.
Sergey was like a genius or something.
I mean, to be fair, He apparently also just didn't sleep well the night before, and he was not in a very good state. So if he was actually at 100%, he might have probably scored similarly to me. Alex, I think, got 135 or something. He was like slightly over.
Oh, wow, really?
I don't think he actually joined. And to be fair, the real smart move is not joining, because the joining just means you now pay a membership fee. And as far as I can tell, there's no benefits.
Yeah. So that's like, what I was wondering. Like, what exactly is the benefits besides being able to tell people you're part of Mensa?
So,
like, when do they call you into action?
I have considered whether or not it might look good on job applications to be like, hey, I'm in Mensa.
Mm-hmm.
But at that point, I might as well just give them the test results. Be like, hey, here's a copy of the letter where they say I'm smart enough to be in Mensa. And also smart enough not to actually sign up. And like, it's like,
yeah.
I haven't seen any benefits from it, but given that I was one point off without training for the test at all, I'm pretty sure I can make it if I tried. Mm-hmm. If I actually tried, you know.
If they catch you on the right day, I'm sure.
I mean, that's also the thing where there is like fluctuations from day to day, but I, on the memory task, I basically didn't try that hard because I already knew I wasn't going to be good at it. And there was another task where I think it was the dice throwing one where apparently I got a lot wrong, so he gets a lot better at those. So he was like, oh no, the things you were saying are completely wrong. So mm-hmm. if I trained those and the short-term memory stuff, I should be able to score a lot better on those. I'm pretty sure the math ones I got entirely correct. I didn't actually get the exact breakdown, so I don't know that, but I'm pretty confident I got those correct. So I'm pretty sure I could make it if I just tried a bit harder, but again, right, like actually joining Mensa, probably not the smartest move, ironically enough.
Yeah, exactly.
I think Mensa is for people to say that they're smart, not that they necessarily are.
I'm sure if the world is in dire need of something, though, they're going to call the Mensa members together at some point to brainstorm for something, right?
They would probably
what's the point of it?
They would just call them subject matter experts, right? It's like, because...
you would think, but what's the point of Mensa?
I mean, I think networking for the most part, right? It's like, you get to know other people that are in Mensa. You could probably get an easier time getting introductions at like, you know, like job. It's probably easier to get job interviews if you know someone who's already working there.
It's easier to
get to know people that work there if you are in an organization that is focusing on, like, say, intelligent people, right? So if you want to get into like something that has association with intelligence, you might have an easier time then. But
mm-hmm.
it all seems a little tenuous. I haven't seen any tangible benefits. And so I'm not exactly intent on joining up, but I might just take the test anyways.
Yeah.
Because again, it's...
I'm too introverted for it anyway. I don't want to go to your meetings.
I mean, you don't have to, right? But
if I was smart enough to go, I don't want to go to them.
So, that is a little off the topic, and I think we have been going for a while, so let's move on to our final segment! Songs of the Week!
Yeah!
What is your song of the week?
Oh, this week it is Guns for Hands by 21 Pilots. What a great song.
Honestly, not the biggest fan, but that's almost to be expected, I think.
It doesn't matter what I play. You're going to immediately follow it with, I'm not the biggest fan.
I mean, it's one of those...
But, go ahead.
I almost want to say it's too new. I mean, obviously, it's not literally that, right? But just, like, stylistically, in some ways, it feels more like the newer pop music. I know that's rock and
roll. Yeah, it is within the past 10 years.
So
they're actually a band that kind of came out of a punk scene, as a matter of fact, but they immediately transitioned into like this new age hip hop punk style. You know, you probably heard the Stressed Out song and things like that. That was really huge, like billions and billions of plays. But yeah, they basically transitioned into pop over the years. But this song here is like special because, as being an American, everyone has guns. We don't even have concealed carry license anymore. Like you don't even have to get registrations for guns. Like if you see somebody outside of your home, they have a gun. Everybody has guns.
I do believe that varies from state to state, but this is not legal advice. But
it does still, but not in Georgia. In Georgia, there's no more concealed carry. There's no more licensing at all. You can just go buy a gun if you want. So everybody in Georgia and Florida and many other states, they all have guns. And metaphorically speaking, it's kind of hard to sleep when you know everyone has a gun and you could get shot at any time.
Yeah, my situation is obviously very different in that A, Germany not that many guns, and B, as long as you're inside of a building, you're fairly safe because we don't have walls made of paper, you know? Okay, actually that's the Japanese, yeah, but States.
Well, like, sheetrock is not much different than paper. But.
Yeah, like the drywall and stuff like that. So yeah, no. Brick walls, I tell you.
Yeah.
You ain't going to shoot through
brick
those.
Brick walls around here. Unless you're in the inner city, then you got a lot of brick walls and cement and stuff like that. But in the suburbs, like, no, all these houses are just wood and sheetrock.
Yeah, that's completely different over here. I think some of like the very new ones also do that. Like that has like become more of a thing a little bit, but like houses that were built like at least 20 years ago, probably at least 30 years ago, like those are probably almost entirely like brick houses. And I mean, you do occasionally see like some variations. Like I remember there being a wooden house that I saw that I would see like near my school, which was interesting. Like out of like big like big like tree trunks, like, and that was interesting. But for the most part, yeah, it's like bricks and cement, but mostly I would say like mostly probably bricks, just
yeah it's actually kind of rare.
You're not gonna shoot
through these days.
You're not gonna shoot through a brick wall with a handgun. I mean, if you keep
these kids are riding around with AK-47s nowadays.
I mean,
it's like a rack out here.
I think in terms of impact force and caliber, that's probably not the... I think the brick wall is going to survive that unless you like keep shooting the exact same spot over and over.
Yeah, in the same spot. Yeah,
or if you want to kill someone, right, like the windows probably are the spot where I would actually want to shoot.
Yeah.
But I mean, sometimes you hear stories out of the States where like someone was just like asleep in their bed or something, and like, or they were just out and about in their house, and like a bullet just comes through the wall. And from like the hallway or the neighbor's place, I'm like, huh?
Yeah, happens all the time.
Like,
yeah, people die by strays all the time. Yeah,
that just wouldn't happen here because, again, right, like even if someone had a gun, which they probably haven't, but like, walls.
Yeah. But just explain it to you why it's tough to sleep over here, man.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to live there, honestly. Like, I used to think...
Yeah, you don't know what it's like to wake up in the middle of the night to a drive-by. Like, you've never experienced stuff like that.
I don't.
Like,
and I don't intend to, honestly. No, it's a thing, right?
Where it happens here.
As a kid, you see the States, and it's like, oh, this seems like a cool place. And I've never been one of those people where it's like, oh, the United States is so great, right? Like occasionally you have those in Europe as well, where it's like, people just think the U.S. is so much better. But I wasn't that necessarily, but, you know, it's been cool. Like, I could have definitely seen myself there, and, you know, the more you learn about it, and, you know. Also, the more time progresses right? Like, your politics is getting worse in a lot of ways.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. There's things you can do to mitigate it, you know. Don't go to gas stations after dark. You know, don't argue with people in traffic because they all have guns. Believe me, they all have guns. I know it's tempting when someone cuts you off, you want to blow and you want to yell at them and flip them off. They have guns.
I feel like that also doesn't happen as much over here.
Yeah.
You don't really hear about road rage that much.
Day.
But also the other thing is, obviously,
road rage is
the Germans, notoriously orderly drivers, right? So, people are also not as likely to cut you off to begin with.
Yeah.
It's wild because it sounds like you live in an entirely different world. Which...
Yeah.
I understand the issues that you got around there. It's not surprising to hear that. But it's so far removed from my reality, right?
Yeah, I bet. Oh, trust me. I mean, we, at least most of us, actually, I can't even say most of us, but a lot of us do think, it must be nice to live in, one of those European countries, move to Denmark, where there's almost no crime whatsoever, and just seems so peaceful.
I think in Denmark, you've got 2 years of maternity leave. That here.
Say what?
I think in Denmark, you've got Denmark 2 years of maternity leave.
Oh, yeah.
And in the U.S., you got none.
You get 6 months here. Yeah, exactly. Okay. That's what I was saying. I don't even think you could get 6 months at the moment. Not even 6 months. You probably get 6 weeks.
It depends probably on the country, on the company that you work for. There might be some state level laws, but there's definitely no federal law. So it's also like days off or sick days. Pretty much every country in Europe has unlimited sick days. Just saying. What the fuck?
That's crazy.
What's wrong with
that's
your country?
That's crazy.
Regular workers be striking to get 4 sick days, and I'm like, huh? They don't get sick days?
You got unlimited sick days?
Yeah!
How does that work?
You don't go to work when you're sick!
Couldn't people just be like, okay, I'm taking off a year. I'm still sick. Can't come in. Keep paying me.
I mean, generally, I think always, but definitely when you are missing for multiple days, you do need a doctor's note, but...
Okay.
I mean, to be fair,
that makes sense.
Most people can easily find a doctor where if you act a little sick, you can get a week off, right? If you really want to push it, but it's also not exactly, it's a little frowned upon as well. But generally speaking, if you're actually sick, you're sick, you can't work, right? That's just how it works.
Whereas many of us can't afford to see a doctor. So,
I mean, yeah, there's that those also. Are free. I mean, they're covered by insurance, they're not technically free, I suppose, in a way, but... doctors... I think hospitals, I'm not entirely sure how that works, but doctors, you don't even, it's not like you hand them money and then you have to get it back from the insurance. It's just you hand them your insurance card and you're done, right? So, I think hospitals are that too. I'm not 100% sure.
Oh, man.
Anyways.
Yeah, definitely... Don't want to live here anymore. But anyway, what's your song?
My song of this week is Brown Sugar by the Rolling Stones.
Yeah. Was that album cover necessary, though?
I mean, that's the album that it's from.
I don't know if this happens to be Mick or who, but that album cover is just not necessary. was that a selling point? Good song, though, man. I like the Rolling Stones.
I, too, do like the Stones. I think the I saw the singles cover for the single actually has them holding the album in front of their crotches, so, you know.
I bet. Yeah. Well, I got a good idea that'll sell tons of records just off the album cover.
There was I'm forgetting the song, but I was thinking of another song that might have also sold some. My Sharona that probably also sold some copies. You can look that up.
Oh yeah.
In your own time, but
I want to see what the album cover is now. We covered My Sharona recently,
and I believe on the cover that actually is Sharona Alperin. So, the woman that the song was written for. But I digress.
Pussy.
It's not that egregious, but it's definitely noticeable.
Well, I mean, you know, suggestive, just like the Rolling Stones cover. Yeah.
But I believe that brings this episode of the Trash Talk Podcast to a close.
Yeah.
Obviously, don't forget to check out the Trash Talkers. Link is in the description below. Otherwise, if you want to see more episodes like this, you can also subscribe to this channel. You can leave a like on the video if you enjoyed it. If you want to talk to us, leave a comment or join the Discord server. Link to that is also in the description below. Smokey.
That's it.
That's it.